Welcome, Andrew.
Thank you.
Of course, the question is, what is enlightenment? You have a magazine that's called What is Enlightenment? And so answer the question to start with.
Well, I'm still trying to figure it out. I used to think that the answer was very simple, but the more I've looked into it, I found out it seems to be quite elusive. It's an elusive question. So generally speaking, I think maybe it would be, the meaning could be understood as a human being coming to some sense of resolution with what it means to be alive, and maybe embracing the possibility of perfect goodness, of becoming a perfectly good creature on this planet where life is often so confusing.
When you say that, I think you mean something like holiness.
I mean goodness, because often I think in the world we're living in, human beings are often very divided in their motivations, and often human beings feel very unhappy and feel very rotten, feel very angry and depressed. And so maybe we could look at this spiritual understanding as one as the conscious appreciation of what goodness or perfect goodness is. Because that's something in this world I think that's very rare, and often it's very difficult for people to even understand what perfect goodness is, because there's so much inside us that seems to be so so far from anything like that. So I think we could understand enlightenment could be understood as the goal of becoming perfectly good. Mm-hmm. Perfectly.
But that brings us to the next question. And what is good? Because we just saw that America bombed Baghdad, Saddam Hussein. I'm sure that many people in Baghdad think that Saddam Hussein is a good guy, and many Americans think that he is a bad guy. So what is goodness? Some kind of measurement, some kind of idea of what goodness is then?
Well, the goodness I'm speaking about has to do with the human being's motivation. Because often our human motivations are very divided. They're often not very wholesome. Often our what motivates us to make choices and do things is selfishness and self-concern. So I think that I'm referring to a state of consciousness where our motivations in relationship to life itself had become wholesome and good, simple, pure, and true, rather than, you know, divided and questionable and dark and shadowy.
Maybe, and it sounds simple, but if you see the human being as having some what you could call animalistic things, you defend yourself, you sometimes attack when you feel the people around you are being attacked. In the eyes of other people, that might look like not very good, but you can do it because obviously you want to defend yourself. Those are little, you know, instincts.
Yeah.
And then there is a level where, like we sit here now, we can talk about the goodness of the world, which is fairly easy because we're well fed and happy and, you know, it's not such good weather, but it's warm. So between those two levels of where it's easy to be good and where it's hard to be good, and I think that last level is where people struggle. They don't have enough money, stuff like that. How can you be good if you are really trying to survive?
Yeah, but I think it's interesting to consider the fact that even when people are not struggling to survive, when they have plenty of money in the bank, when they have a lot of food to eat, when they're very comfortable, often they're very unhappy, and also they're very angry and still very selfish. So what I'm speaking about, I don't think really has that much to do with our material circumstances. It has to do with a much deeper understanding of what it really means to be a human being who's aware of the fact that he or she is actually alive. I mean, the fact is that most people don't really have a relationship to life that's based on a radical or absolute simplicity. Most people feel very hurt, wounded, victimized, live in an awful lot of emotional and psychological pain, and many people feel very angry and frustrated.
Yeah, but they call this the human condition. I mean, this is it.
I know. Well, that's exactly right. So the question is, what is enlightenment here? And I was saying, I was pointing to the understanding of an ultimate attainment of a condition of perfect goodness. It means that one had come to an understanding in relationship to life that was perfectly wholesome and good, and that one's motivations in relationship to being a human being and being alive had become very simple and wholesome, good, and true.
Well, that's possible. I mean, I could sit here and, by the grace of God, I believe I could become enlightened right now, suppose it is, but then I step out in this world and I, you know, there are stolen bikes outside and misery.
But that's the challenge. But the whole point is to be an individual who's an expression of goodness and simplicity in the world that is fundamentally divided is really what the great challenge of enlightenment is.
Mm-hmm. But what you're really saying is that we could do away with the notion of enlightenment if we brought it down to some more simple terms, live your life good, yes? What you feel is good in relation to whatever is around you.
Well, I think that's a little bit...
too simplistic.
A little bit too simplistic because when we look into what simplicity really points to, it actually becomes very subtle because we can say that... Often the condition that the human being is in, or the unenlightened condition, could be one of division and complexity. And we could say that the awakened or enlightened condition was one of simplicity and wholeness. Mm-hmm. Now, in the simplicity, there's great subtlety, because when all of the individual's attention and energy becomes very unified and very concentrated and very focused, it also becomes very subtle and very powerful. Often our attention is very scattered, it's very diffused, and it's often very gross. That's why it's very difficult for us to see very deeply into our own experience or to see very deeply into life itself. But when we become very focused and very concentrated and ultimately become whole and very simple, we begin to see very deeply into the nature of life, into the nature of existence, and to begin to experience a very deeper relationship to what it means to be alive.
So you imply that really the central theme is here is attention, because we influence what we see, but how do we look at the world, and that brings us to reality, because in your view there's two realities. There's what people would call everyday reality, which is full of misery and this and that and that, and then there is that same reality, which is physically not different, but seen by different eyes, is totally different, is like perfect, and the lion eats the whatever, the sheep, and so on, but there is a certain perfection in that. So at the same time, you can see the same thing as misery and as total happiness. Isn't that what Christ said? Heaven is now, we just don't see it?
Well, that may be true, but that's not really what I'm referring to. When I speak about attention, it has to do with, where is the attention of the individual? Where is my attention? Where is your attention? Where is the individual's attention in every moment? Most people really haven't begun to consider really what the most important thing in life is. And I don't think the spiritual life can even begin unless the individual really thinks very deeply to himself or herself, for himself or for herself, about really what is the most important thing in life. You know, who am I and how shall I live? What is the reason that I'm here? Because it's very difficult to live this life in earnest without a sense of meaning and purpose and significance.
Okay, but then what is for you the meaning of life?
What's for me the meaning of life? The meaning of life to me is love.
Yeah, I agree. I go one step further. For me, the meaning of life is to live in the shadow of the love of God. It's a little bit more complex, but probably the same.
Why do you want to live in the shadow?
What do you think this is?
I don't see any shadows here.
Reality.
I don't see any
in
shadows.
Some reality is in some way the shadow.
Not necessarily.
Of the love of God.
Not necessarily. There's not necessarily any shadows here.
it's a
dualistic notion.
Yes, it is a dualistic notion that works out with that God created Earth, or that it was created as a tool for us to understand. But the total love of God would be blinding, and so the reality is there to give us an understanding of the differences.
Well, I really think that the whole point, or at least the whole point is really to become simple, and when we become very simple, the way becomes very clear. Now, as long as we want to live for ourselves, live to have, to get, to consume, to inquire, to become, then it's going to be very difficult for us to be able to see the way for ourselves, because we're going to be too busy grasping, wanting, consuming. Very much concerned with how much we can have for ourselves. But when we come to the end of a self-centered relationship to life, which is the whole point of the spiritual life and the whole point of spiritual experience and spiritual practice.
Wait a minute. When we come to a self-centered...
The end.
At the end.
When we come to the end of a self-centered relationship to life and human experience, then everything begins to change. Then we begin to understand the meaning and purpose of existence. A lot of things begin to become clear to us, and our heart begins to open, our mind becomes very clear, and we experience very much a sense of being very much at the center of everything, very much at one with the source of life itself. Because we begin to appreciate that happiness is found through giving and not through taking.
Yet most people say, when they hear the word love, they think, yeah, but I do it, but I want something back.
Yeah, but that's not love. That's not love.
Love is...
Love is not receiving. Love has nothing to do with receiving or getting. It has only to do with giving. In the experience of profound love, one feels utterly destroyed. One doesn't feel like one has acquired anything. One does not feel that one has gained anything. One feels that everything has been taken away and one is left completely and utterly empty. That's what the true experience of love is. But the common understanding of what love is really very materialistic and has everything to do with the ego or the separate sense of self. It doesn't have anything to do with what impersonal or absolute love is. Because true love, impersonal or absolute love, takes everything from us. It doesn't really give us anything. Mm-hmm. And when everything is removed, you see, that's when we recognize ourselves to be non-separate from life. And we begin to see very, very deeply what the whole point is.
These kind of notions, mystical notions that all is one, the all is the one, that we are the all and that above and below, all those things have been said. Now, the everyday Amsterdam person says, yeah, that's all nice and good, but when I go out in the street, I see very few good people, let alone enlightened people.
Well, that doesn't really matter if everybody you see is rotten, or it doesn't matter if everybody you see is a Nazi. The main thing that matters is what you're doing, what I'm doing. We have to be. I think it's very easy to see the faults in others.
No, but it would be I think it's nice to see at one time that there's good people.
It would be nice. It would be nice, and I hope one day that we will be able to go out in the street and see all kinds of wonderful people. It would be very heartwarming. But in the meantime, I think in order for that to happen, if I begin to do everything that I need to do to become simple and whole and pure-hearted and have a very pure intention, and you do everything that you need to do to become simple, whole, and pure-hearted and of pure intention, then slowly there's going to be more and more of those people out there.
Yeah, but people will say, we've heard his story. 2,000 years ago, there was Jesus Christ, and there was the Buddha, and there was Muhammad.
There's nothing new about any of this.
We didn't make it yet. Yeah?
Yeah, of course. But the thing is, of course, we haven't made it yet. But making it, when one person makes it, then it's happened. And then when another person makes it, then it's happened. So if we want the world to change, then we have to be committed to making that change within ourselves right now, unconditionally. If we really care about the misery and the suffering that we see in the world around us, then we have to become committed to an absolute transformation of ourselves. Because everything that we see outside ourselves that disturbs us
is a projection.
In the world, well, those same tendencies usually exist inside ourselves. And if we want the world to change, then we have to purify ourselves of those very same tendencies. And in that way, the world really will begin to change. And it will literally begin to change because we will see the world differently and our relationship to the world will change. And that will have an effect.
Well, I happen to agree with you that that's how things work.
Oh, good.
But that's not what people that went to church in Holland after the war, when I grew up, we went to church and all sort of. And many, many people said, yeah, there were the same stories. I mean, basically, your story is not different from the Buddha story or the Christ story, yes? Do unto others as you do unto yourself. Love is the most important. It's all there. And yet they got bored with the church. They don't have this experience.
But you understand, we live in a world where most people are very cynical. And even in a beautiful city like this, where everybody has so much, people are deeply cynical and very selfish.
Mm-hmm.
And this cynicism itself is what keeps the possibility of what I'm speaking about very, very far away from us.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing new about anything that I'm saying, but the thing is that that which is most important in life has always been, you know, it's been called the pearl of great price. And it's only people who have become very mature and very serious and very sincere that they begin to really recognize that it's completely up to them. It's completely up to them. I mean, it's easy to look at the world around us and become cynical and bitter and see all the hypocrisy and compromise and just throw up our hands in disgust. But when we do that, we let ourselves off the hook. Because it's really not up to anybody else, it's up to us. And that's really what my point is. I mean, even if no one else in the whole world was interested, it's still up to us.
Yeah, true.
Because I actually feel that, in a sense, the evolution of the race as a whole lies on the shoulders of the individual who recognizes that it does. Because, for example, when one individual recognizes that everything is up to them, their relationship to their experience changes. If we always believe that someone else is going to do it and someone else is going to assume responsibility, then our tendency is going to be to compromise. But when we realize that it really is up to us, and if we're not going to do it, then no one's going to do it, then it puts a little bit more, it creates a certain kind of intensity, and a sense of reality begins to dawn on us. It gives us a tremendous energy and strength to transform ourselves that ordinarily might not be there. And I do believe it literally does rest on the shoulders of the individual.
Yeah, but don't you, by that way, put the same burden that was put on us when I was young and went to church? You know, you have to live a holy life, not because it came from me, but it was like an external force that said, oh, you don't do this, don't do this. We give you the Ten Commandments. We give you all the rules of life, and then you're good. Yeah?
No, that's not what I'm talking about.
No, I know it's not, but that's what people will feel. So, yeah, this Mr. Andrew Cohen is very nice, and he tells nice stories, but we are here, and we have to live our lives. Let's come to some practical things.
But listen, we all have to live our lives, so the question is, is our relationship to life fundamentally a selfish one, or is it an unselfish one? If we want the world to change, we as individuals have to begin to look into what our motivations are. And when we begin to look and question in this way, often what we find isn't very pretty. The reason that the world is so full of conflict is because the individuals that make it up are so full of conflict. So if the individuals that are so full of conflict are so upset about it, then they have to begin to question themselves. And that's the only way anything's going to really change.
Well, I agree with the question, but we come to the fundamental point why I really like to talk to you, because from your books and from your teaching, and I've followed a few of your lectures, I got the impression that at least the people sitting there have an idea that there are enlightened people and there are non-enlightened people. And when I look at your magazines, you give pictures of people that are so-called enlightened or realized, whatever. Now, in my view, if there is fairness in creation, then everybody is realized and everybody is the same. That there is no separation between those who
life
are...
Life isn't fair. Life isn't
oh, I
fair.
Think it is fair. I think that it is me. When I look at someone out in the street who is like, oh, he's a bum, and I think I'm better than him, I might, you know, even if there's a scale in enlightenment, which probably there isn't, but I feel more enlightened than he does. That's only because I didn't care to look into the person. I didn't understand his masks, his defense systems, the way he became like he was. Because in himself, I'm very sure, and I have not yet met a single person in my life that in the depth of their being were not totally good.
Oh, really?
So I don't take your division in people that are enlightened and that are not.
Well, I didn't realize we'd spoke about that yet. We haven't really talked about that yet, have we?
No, but okay, let's talk about it. And who is enlightened and who isn't?
Well, that's a very good question. But the thing is, if we talk about enlightenment in an ambiguous way, or in ways that are very mystical, the question becomes very confusing and very difficult to understand, difficult to grasp. But if we speak about spiritual attainment in relationship to our humanity, then it becomes something that is not that difficult for anybody to understand, and it's something that we can really it's something that can help us to understand our own relationship to life. But if we begin to look at these spiritual questions in ways that are too mystical, it really leaves our humanity out of the picture, and ultimately, I think, is probably not really that useful.
No, I tend to agree that discussions about these things, if it doesn't come to real life, and in real life, I think it's important to whoever you see to love them. But coming back to, so what is enlightenment and who is enlightened? In your book, you have pictures of the Dalai Lama, all kinds of Indian gurus. Are they enlightened?
I guess some are and some aren't. I haven't met them all.
Well, I've met many of them. I've met the Dalai Lama and a few of these guys. I don't care, personally, whether they're enlightened or not. They're usually very interesting chaps.
Yeah.
Or women. Yeah.
Right, uh-huh.
And we get a lot of them in Amsterdam. We had Amma a few weeks ago, and many people, Isaac Shapiro, many, many people. They're very interesting people. And mm-hmm. It feels like they indeed have come to some realization. And that the most realization is that they are not so much different from me or from other people. What I sense is a certain humbleness, a certain a feeling of no separation. You don't feel separated from them. So that makes, for me, enlightenment a very simple thing. If they don't pretend to be different, they're probably enlightened. From your stories, I get this feeling that for you, enlightenment is something to be attained. A status, a level.
No, definitely. Definitely. It's something very special, something very precious. It's not something that's ordinary or cheap to acquire. It's something that one has to make a lot of sacrifices for if it's something that's real, if it's something that's really worthwhile, definitely. Most people don't want to pay the price. The great Krishnamurti said, if you knew what it was, you wouldn't touch it with a 10-foot pole.
Why? Is it so hard?
Is because most people don't want to make the sacrifice that's necessary in order to achieve it. Most people are far too attached to their individuality, to their personality, to their separateness, to their identity, to their history, to their memory, to their pride. And the idea of living without all that is not something that most people are interested in. Absolutely.
You said some of these people do have it. Your magazine is about interviews with those people. Dalai Lama is probably best known. Barry Long, whom I interviewed. Margot Anand, which I interviewed. As I say, very nice people. But why are they better? Why are they attained?
Well, I haven't met all those people.
Excuse me, but your magazine describes them. And I, as I said again, very nice people. And what unites them is mostly their sense of connection. They connect. Now, if that is true, then the farmer out in the field might be as enlightened as these guys.
It's possible. Maybe he might be more enlightened.
I hope so. But tell me about a little bit about your background, because you have been to India.
Yeah, I teach a retreat there every winter.
Yeah, but you started out in India with your spiritual quest long time ago, or not?
Well, I started before I went to India. I was looking since I was in my 20s.
And you come from New York?
Yeah, New York City.
So you're a Jewish boy from New York?
Jewish boy from New York, yeah.
Yeah. Do you have still a relationship with the Jewish faith?
None at all.
Not at all? Never had?
Never had, no. But when I was I was teaching in Israel, for about 5 years, I was going twice a year. I would go meet different rabbis and speak to them about spiritual matters. But they all wanted to get me back for themselves.
Yeah, they do. But they're a funny lot too, aren't they?
Sure.
Yeah. Yesterday we had some Jewish musicians here in Amsterdam. I love the music. I love the emotions that go with it. But you yourself, you went searching in India.
Yeah. Yeah.
How did you do? You went on a plane and looked behind the stones? How does that work?
Well, I mean, I think the most important thing is being very sincere in one's desire for liberation. One doesn't have to go to India for these things. It has to do with, has one come to a point in one's life where one actually feels desperate, then one can't bear to compromise any longer.
Oh, I'm sure you can find it in Amsterdam, but this change that you make a decision and say, I'm going to India, which is a different country or whatever, brings you in, it opens your eyes. But is it true that, if the student is ready, the teacher will show?
I don't know for sure. It all depends.
It happened in your case?
Yeah, it happened in my case.
Yeah, you found a guru somewhere?
Yeah, but I don't want to go into my personal history. It's not that interesting.
Well, it's interesting for people to see that many of what we call Western gurus went to India and found something there which they didn't find, say, in the Jewish tradition where they could have come from, or the Christian tradition. I find so very few, traditional Western Judeo-Christian gurus. It seems not our thing in the West.
Yeah, but quite a bit is changing. I mean, there's a tremendous interest in spirituality in the West now, and especially in the last 10 years. I mean, there's an explosion of interest, and it's a lot of earnestness also. You know, there are a lot of people who are getting pretty desperate and are beginning to really feel that something has to change.
But does it have anything to do with the purity, say, the non-technological, the non-causal thinking of the East that brings people there?
Well, I think in the East there's a very developed understanding of the fact that the mind in itself is inherently limited, and in order to have a deeper apprehension of reality, one has to go beyond the mind in order to find it. And I think in the East that's very deeply understood, and it's not something that was so clearly understood in the West, until now. I think more and more people are beginning to understand this.
The beginning to understand that, because when you say the mind is more important, when I think about India, I don't think about luxury cars and big hotels. I think, well, you go to an ashram there, or you find a guru. These guys usually are not very rich, or, you know, don't expect...
Well, some are. Some are very rich and have nice cars and big ashrams.
Yeah, but in general, you go there and you do away with the material things. Is that part of that process of attaining a realization?
Well, it can be, you know, it can be, but it has to do with being willing to take a leap beyond everything that we've ever known. It's a leap that involves leaving behind our memory and all the ideas we've ever had about who we think we are or who God is. It has to do with really being willing to give up the world in the shape of our own mind and our own thoughts. That's really what
is it. Really
it
that
possible.
Drastic? I mean, do you have
yes.
to?
Yes. It really is that
you have to stop believing what you believed before.
You have to be willing to look beyond everything that you ever believed in order to find out what lies beyond the mind. That's where the secret is found.
Mm-hmm. American would then ask, what's the payoff? I mean, what does that bring you? Yeah, you travel around the world. These people travel around the world. You just came from the States. You do an interview with me. I'm sure you suffer a little bit from jet lag. You're giving lectures. You gave yourself a pretty busy life there.
Well, I've given myself a pretty busy life because I care about other people. And I think it's important that people who care are able to hear what it is that I'm saying and maybe respond to it.
Yeah, but so there's some personal cost for you, which brings me again to the question, like when I had an interview with Barry Long, I know he has some medical problems. Gee, why do you do this, guy? It's good for the people, but you yourself are sacrificing your body by doing it. Now, you're young and you look very healthy, but still, why do people give up their life for someone else? Is that love? Is that what you call love?
No, it's a command from God. It's a command.
Are you saying you couldn't do anything else?
Yes.
Huh. That's interesting. There. So, do you feel chosen then, like, or called?
Yeah, very much so.
Well, that's good. Now, you not only talk to people, but you have put your ideas to paper. Did you do it yourself, or are these written down lectures?
Both.
Both.
Both. Yeah.
What is your main theme in your books? I see the promise of perfection, freedom has no past, freedom translated, and...
Has no history.
Has no history, and living unconditionally.
An unconditional relationship to life.
Unconditional. You see that people translate it so easy. These books are, by the way, available in Holland, I'm sure. What is your main theme in the books?
Liberation.
Liberation from the doom of reality, or what we talked before?
No,
this
from human from ignorance. From ignorance and selfishness, self-deception. the possibility of discovering a real meaning and purpose and liberation from misery.
Yeah. Now, some people say that you can only learn about realization from a master, from a guru, so someone who shows you in life. Does it help to read books like this? Or you say it's part of the path?
Well, it can definitely be a big help. But it all depends on whose books you're reading.
Of course, there's many books, but...
Listen, there's a lot of gurus and teachers out there, and they're not all the same. They're not all they all say they're teaching the same thing, but like in anything else in life, they're definitely not necessarily. Mm-hmm. Some people know what they're talking about. Some people don't. Some people are more confused than others. It's not all the same.
Well, you say there's a qualification. There's good, but is there also... Are there more paths to realization? Are there more paths to the truth? Are there multiple truths in this field?
Well, ultimately, the truth is one. Because it's only in that that you and I can really come together and meet, isn't it? In that truth that isn't personal.
No, but we've had on this spot a very deep discussion about the nature of reality. Is this a manifestation of God, the good side, the bad guys, you know, what is evil? Those discussions, especially in the Hindu tradition, go very deep. And there are different opinions. And it's not like in the end that we say, yeah, we all agree. No, there's still this...
But don't you think if there is such a thing as truth, that if it was the truth, it would be beyond anybody's opinion of it?
Absolutely. There is an ultimate truth.
It would be an absolute fact.
Yeah. But we couldn't get there.
Whether you and I disagreed or had different opinions about it, it wouldn't have anything... It wouldn't alter it at all, would it? It wouldn't affect it.
No. Actually, I'm not sure there. I'm not sure that there are not multiple ultimate truths, because I haven't been close enough to
you
watch.
You can't have multiple ultimate truths. You can have multiple relative truths, but you can't have multiple ultimate or absolute truths. There can only be one ultimate or absolute truth, just by the definition of the language.
Mm-hmm. Well, it seems that existing religions in the world have differed about
definitions,
it.
Different definitions, sure.
Definitions of years and years. How does your teaching relate to those traditional teachings?
Oh, it agrees with many. It agrees with many. It says that there's an absolute reality, and it says that that we need to discover and experience that reality in order to begin to make sense out of human life, out of our own life. And I think a very big part of the spiritual path and spiritual practice is about helping the individual to find a way to make sense out of the human condition, the human predicament. It's a very big part of it.
And that's what all religions in one way or another seem to do. Try to do, okay. But it comes down to some, I would say, but fine points like you have to eat vegetarian or not. You know, you start out with the ultimate truth and it comes down, don't eat meat or do eat meat or whatever. Do you feel that it has to come down to that level of life regulations?
From a certain point of view, at certain times it might have to, but I think that there's more important things to worry about than that. Like looking very deeply into our own heart and really seeing what's motivating us, mm-hmm. I think is more important than these other issues. Because you can be a vegetarian and still be a Nazi. Hitler was a vegetarian.
So, practical things. Do you advocate for the people that follow you to meditate? When you just said looking into your heart, is that a certain way?
Yeah, yes, meditation helps to get in touch with depth. Yeah, it helps one to experience oneself beyond the mind. It helps a lot.
It helps.
Yeah.
I noticed I went to your a couple of times to your teachings, and I didn't care so much about your stories because I said, well, nice stories. But there was a certain moment when you asked for silence, and people to close their eyes, and I opened my eyes, and there was, and this is very personal, I saw a total golden glow. All the people in the room, including you, were gold. There was like a golden shine, and I thought, gee, what have I eaten today? You know, we're in Amsterdam, there are some pills around it, but I hadn't. And I said, gee, this is really special. So I had that experience. Now, I've had it with a few other people. The guy from the TM movement,
Maharishi
Mahesh Yogi, he had the same thing. let's put it very personal. I had the same experience. Is that something that you are aware of that you do to people?
Well, I don't do it. It just happens by itself.
Okay. Are you aware of the fact that it happens?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. Do you have an explanation for that phenomenon?
Do I have an explanation for it?
Yeah.
The explanation is I told you that I didn't have a choice in doing what I'm doing, that I was commanded to do it. So the same source or energy or consciousness that commanded me to do this is what it was that you saw and what you felt when you came to see me.
Yeah, I experienced it, I believe, or whatever we call it, but then why was it gold? Why wasn't it red? Why weren't we all floating? I mean, I have an inquisitive mind, and I thought about it. I said, why does this guy radiate that kind of energy? And as I said, some other people did.
What was the quality, but how did it make you feel, the energy?
Well, to be very honest, it did two things for me. I thought, gee, this is nice. Really nice. And then I looked around and I saw that the people around me got into this, ease of use, let's call this golden state. All together with you created, or they created, or it was created, whatever, there was a very nice atmosphere. And yes, at that moment, the reality of the world was pushed away. And I could see in the face of the people that the reality was seen different. They came there with all their personal thing, maybe their legs hurt or whatever. That was gone for a while. That was one point. But the other realization was, for me, I think I even wrote a poem about it. I said, well, I like the gold, but I think nature has many colors. I'll go for them.
Why?
Because I realized it was also a kind of, I was
happy?
Not so much happy, because I'm usually happy, but I felt that I got into a mind state.
Yeah.
That separated me also from the reality of things, of the beauty that is in that colors.
Did it separate you, or did it make you feel closer? Because usually in deep meditation, people actually feel closer to themselves and to reality, not really separate from it. And in that state, they realize how far away they are most of the time.
It made me feel separate from the misery.
It's interesting.
And for me, because misery is not misery. Misery, as I said before, is the shadow of the love of God. If you look at reality, at all the various colors that are, and some might not be so nice, if you feel that, and if you look at it, that is really what life is for me, a challenge, you know? See this bum, this homeless in Amsterdam, we have homeless people. I went to them, we made homeless TV, and I learned to like those guys. Yeah, there was wisdom in them, and they knew about the street, and sometimes they choose that life. And that was a very deliberate choice that they made all through their life, that they wanted to live on the street, that they wanted that freedom. So in their misery, for everybody else looking at them, they say, no good clothes, and maybe smells and stuff like that, but they had their own choice. So yes, it's nice to see gold, it's nice to feel happy, but there was I also felt it as a kind of delusion.
Oh, you didn't feel it was real?
Everything is real. I was very taken by the fact that it was real. That you had the capability to make people feel different.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that their view of reality at that moment changed.
Yeah.
But afterwards, or really at the same moment, I realized, but he is like a wizard. This is what the church has been doing all the time. They ask you to come to the church. You sing together. they have the gold tools and whatever, and you feel good, and then you go back in reality with the feeling, I don't have to do anything about it, because...
So, I'm a sorcerer and a wizard, then? Is that
one possibility, yes.
Is that white sorcery or black sorcery?
Oh, well, I don't know. Magic is a whole different story. But what I saw, that the people there... And that's another thing that I noticed, is that the people like that. That is the kind of people that is looking for the gold in the world. That you attract that kind of people that are looking for the gold in their lives. Because
But the thing is, there's something very important here that's really not in the picture. Is that basically the whole point of everything that I teach is that it's one thing to experience peace, joy, bliss, fullness, and it's important that people have a chance to experience that depth of peace, joy, bliss, and fullness in order to know what's possible. But then the whole point of the spiritual life and the whole point of spiritual practice and spiritual commitment is to become a living expression and manifestation of that fullness and that bliss and that peace as ourselves, as our humanity. And so, on one hand, I understand what you were saying when you said, well, you experienced this joy and this peace, but you realize that this is not the whole picture, but the whole point...
No, there's more colors except gold.
Right, but the challenge of the spiritual life is to become transformed as a human being and to become an expression of that simplicity and that fullness as ourselves, as our humanity, as our individuality, and that's what the whole point is. So it's one thing to experience peace, joy, and bliss, you know, in a certain environment or a certain environment that makes that possible, but it's another thing to live that simplicity and that fullness in this world of complexity and conflict, and that's really what the whole challenge of the spiritual life is all about.
Because it's a challenge. It's not like in the days of St. Francis that you could say, hey guys, you've learned it, here are the smocks or whatever, the dresses of the brotherhood, and go out and, you know, serve the world. These people go home and
when those brothers had to go out and serve the world, then they that was a big challenge too. It is a big challenge to go out and to speak about this kind of simplicity and beauty in an unbelieving and cynical world.
It is. And that's also the challenge of this program, to speak about this other world, about our experience. I hope we shared something about that, my personal feelings about it. I think that's important. Is there anything you want to add?
No, thank you. It was great.
Okay.
So these two things have in the center that of Congo, slavery.
It's all the same thing.
So, and you're totally committed that this will eventually eat the whole... Now you can say it's a stupid idea, but it's not true.